Hello, Mount Sinai. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious Father, once again we come asking for your blessings, asking that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive you, to receive your word anew. In Jesus' name, amen. So, how's everybody doing? Again, we are studying the Articles of Faith, and we have continued to be on article number 11, the perseverance of saints. And our author writes, "We believe that such only are real believers as endure unto the end, that their persevering attachment to Christ is the grand mark which distinguishes them from superficial professors, that a special providence watches over their welfare, and that they are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation." And once again, our main scripture continues to be John, the 8th chapter, verses 31 and 32, which reads, "To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, 'If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.'" And our focus continues to be on the latter part of verse 32, "and the truth will set you free." It appears that freedom is not something that just happens. Most times, there's a price to be paid. On July 4th, 1776, in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, our founding fathers signed and adopted the Declaration of Independence. With much bloodshed, that document declared our freedom from the kingdom of Great Britain. It declared that we, the United States, or at that time, the 13 colonies, were free from British rules. And so being born here means that we are citizens. And being citizens mean that we enjoy the freedoms that come with being a citizen. Now, I know that your mind can go all over the place from that statement, but that's for another lesson. Freedom costs. It has a cost. There's a never-ending bloody trail called freedom, and that's on the physical side. But it also holds true on the spiritual side. There's a bloody trail that leads to our spiritual freedom. On Friday, over 2,000 years ago, on the outskirts of Jerusalem, on a hill called Skull Hill, Jesus shed his blood to free us from the power of sin. As our U.S. citizenship requires being born into it, so does the kingdom of Jesus, or the kingdom of heaven. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "You must be born again," which is called the new birth or regeneration. Once we are citizens of the kingdom of heaven, as such, there are certain freedoms that we enjoy. Jesus said, "If you hold to my teachings, you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." In John, the 17th chapter, the 17th verse, Jesus says that the word of God is that truth. Then James, the first chapter, verse 25, calls that truth the law of liberty. And the gospel declares that as Christians and as citizens of the kingdom of heaven, we enjoy some great freedoms. And we don't have to die and go to heaven to enjoy them. They are available right here on earth. Romans, the 8th chapter, is the Christian declaration of freedom. In that chapter, Paul declares the four spiritual freedoms that we enjoy by the power of the Holy Spirit because of our union with Christ. 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, verse 17 says, "Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." Our first spiritual freedom that we enjoy as citizens of the heavenly kingdom is found in Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 1 through 4. Freedom from judgment and no condemnation. And we've already discussed that freedom in great length and detail prior to the COVID-19 virus. And so we are currently on our second declaration of freedom, which is found in Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 5 through 17. It says, we have freedom from defeat and no obligation to the flesh. Again today, I'll read verses 5 through 6. Verse 5 says, those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. And so we have been looking at defeat as a mindset. We said that if my mind tells me that I'm defeated, then I'm defeated. But if I change the message that I'm sending to my mind, then my outlook will change. And so we started this study by looking at the mindset of the disciples, and we zoomed in on Peter. Our study went to the scene at the Last Supper when Jesus told Peter that Satan had desired to sift him as wheat, and that Peter would deny even knowing Jesus that very day. But Jesus said to Peter, he says, but I have prayed for you. And even though Peter couldn't make himself believe that he would ever deny Jesus, it did happen. And the Bible says that when Peter realized what he had done, that he went away and wept bitterly. Then, to get an idea of how that could have happened, we took a trip back. We took a study back to the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And we looked as best we could at Peter and the other disciples' mindset for that week prior to the crucifixion. How his mindset went from basically being on top of the world while he was walking with Jesus to that of being defeated. When Peter and the disciples were going into Jerusalem, they really thought that they were going into Jerusalem so that Jesus could establish his kingdom and that they would be a part of the inner circle of the kingdom. And so his mindset went from being on top of the world to that of being defeated when Jesus was crucified, because crucifixion was far from his mind. Peter never thought of crucifixion. He never thought that crucifixion would happen at the end of the week. And so then we made it to the crucifixion, and we looked at how Peter spent Friday, Saturday, in shock, in guilt, in regret. But then Sunday morning came and things changed. Jesus got up from the grave and showed himself to the women that came to the tomb. He showed himself to his disciples on more than one occasion. Then he showed himself to over 500 people at one time. And also, he showed himself to his half-brother, James. And finally, approximately 2 years after his ascension, he showed himself to the Apostle Paul. So last time we left off, it was day 40. Jesus is getting ready to return to his heavenly Father. And Luke, the 24th chapter, starting with verse 45, reads, then he opened their minds so they could understand the scripture. He told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, And repentance and forgiveness of sin will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And then he said, you are witnesses of these things. The disciples were blessed with the privilege of knowing Jesus personally. They were blessed with the privilege of hanging around him for 3 years. They were blessed with the privilege of learning from him, being taught by him, seeing the miracles up close and personal. But privilege always brings with it responsibility. They were to be witnesses of all that he had said and done. Remember last time we said that a witness is one who has information or knowledge of something. And to phrase it another way, if you are one that has information or knowledge about something, then that means that you can give information or knowledge. You can be a witness. You can bring to light or confirm something that has happened. But you must give that information with authority and with power. You must give it like you actually saw it or you actually heard it. And so the disciples were not called to be judges or prosecuting attorneys sent to condemn the world. They were to be witnesses who pointed to Jesus Christ and tell lost sinners how to be saved, how to be a part of the kingdom of heaven. As a witness, one must give information in such a way that it's believable. You can't be a wishy-washy or a mousy believer. You've got to own it. Say it with conviction. State the facts. State them like you know them. And how could a group of common folk, like the disciples, often lacking education, ever hope to accomplish that kind of a commission, to be witnesses to all that they had seen and heard for the whole time that Jesus had been on earth, had been with them for 3 years? Jesus knew that the religious establishment who opposed him would also oppose them. As he continued his ministry, there was great resentment that led to hatred and finally open opposition against him. And Jesus knew the opposition. He knew the opposition, and he knew that even though the disciples were pumped up right now, I mean, they were, because they had seen the risen Savior, they were pumped. They were ready to be witnesses. But Jesus knew that by themselves, they would be no match for the fierce opposition that they were going to face. Thus, in Luke, the 24th chapter, verse 49, Jesus says, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. So God promised to provide the power that they needed for the great task. And when you think about it, he's still promising us that same power for the great task that we have on a daily basis. John, the 15th chapter, verse 26, and this is the New Living Translation, it says, but I will send you the Counselor, the Spirit of Truth. He will come to you from the Father and will tell you all about me. And you must also tell others about me because you have been with me from the beginning. So he's saying the Father is going to send the Comforter and he's going to tell you all about me. And then you must also tell others about me because you have been with me from the beginning. The promise from the Father is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of God is a person. Jesus referred to the Spirit as He and not as it. The Holy Spirit has a mind, has a will, has emotions, have feelings. He is part of the Godhead. Jesus the Son will send the Spirit from the Father to dwell with us and in us. Because the Holy Spirit is a person and is God, it means that as a Christian, we have the God, we have that God indwelling in our bodies. Jesus told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the promised Holy Spirit from the Father. He would take up residence with them. He would be God with them to empower them to do the work. Thus, the witnessing is not something that they would do, but it was something that He would do. The witnessing is not something that they would do for the Lord. It would be something that He would do through them. I think oftentimes that we as Christians are guilty of trying to sell Christ to folk. That there is a great difference between sales talk and a Spirit-empowered witness. Simon Peter came to Jesus because Andrew went after him with a testimony. Andrew was empowered with a testimony that caused Peter to believe and to follow Jesus. As witnesses, we are to go forth in the authority of His name and in the power of His Spirit, proclaiming His gospel. As Christians, we have God indwelling in our body. He lives in us. If the Holy Spirit were not within us, we would not be able to serve the Lord in this present evil world, especially in our day and time. With Christ, we can stand and withstand in the midst of the world's hatred because of the special ministries of the Holy Spirit. Note I said ministries, not ministry. He is not just one thing. He is not just one of what I need. He is everything that I need. He is my everything. I am to walk in the Spirit. I am to worship in the Spirit. I am to witness in the Spirit. And I am to live in the Spirit until Jesus returns or until we die. We must live in this hostile world and face continued opposition. We are following a bloody trail left by our great example. When I look at it through the lens of my physical eyes, it seems like an impossible task. And it is an impossible task in the physical. And how can we do it? We cannot do it in the physical. What is the secret of victory? It is the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit of God in our lives. Jesus said, "I am going to send you what my Father has promised." He says, "But stay in the city until you have been clothed with the power from on high." Luke, the 24th chapter, verse 49 in the Life Application Bible says it like this. It says, "And now I will send the Holy Spirit upon you, just as my Father promised. Don't begin telling others yet. Stay here until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with the power from on high." So they had to wait. And so do you. Until next time. Join us next week, if the Lord permits, on our YouTube channel, Mount Sinai MBC of Memphis Incorporated. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button so that you will have a notification letting you know when we're back. Until then, be blessed, and we love you.